Welcome to Retouch Pro Live. I'm your host, Doug Nelson. Thank you all for showing up today. Want to let everybody know that things are going to move kind of fast today, but don't worry, we're recording everything and it will be uploaded to YouTube in the next day or so. You can see the URL there on your screen. By the way, if you subscribe to the my YouTube channel, you'll get a notification anytime I upload future shows in case you're not able to make them. Speaking of subscribing, I'd appreciate it if you'd follow me on Twitter. I've got a project in mind for a future show that requires some Twitter followers, and that's also where you get your early notice for when the upload page is available for these shows. Speaking of the upload page, I am pasting the URL in now. This is the time when you do your uploading. Please read the rules that are on the upload page. Most importantly, rename your file so that your username is part of the file name so that we know who we're talking about with your when we're looking at your wonderful images that you're going to share with us. Let's see here. Speaking of the chat box, let me show you how that works. You should have a box that says questions. Looks very similar to this. If you don't see this box, click the little arrow here, or it might be a plus sign depending on your operating system. The box will drop down. You type your question in here, you hit send, it comes out on this side. If you did upload an image to go with your question, I'd appreciate it if you just mentioned the image name in the question. That lets us know what to refer to when we are talking. Let's see here, I've done this, I've done that. Let me... We don't have a sponsor yet, so if you'll indulge me here for a second for me to talk about the videos from the previous shows. If you go to retouchpro.com, go to the site nav menu, navigate down to Retouch Pro Videos, give it a click. It will take you to our rental page, where we have the rental archive for all of the previous old format shows. We did them differently than we're doing right now. These are mostly real-time start-to-finish retouch jobs that you actually watch while they are being performed. There's a few exceptions in there. There's some technical shows, but these are all like two and a half hours long, all HD video, all very, very in-depth, high-quality shows, and I'd appreciate it if you would check those out. Another thing you can do, if you are so inclined, again, if you go to the site nav menu and you come down to be a patron, you give that a click and it will take you to our patron subscription page, which is essentially a donation you can make to help us defray expenses here. You can pick a plan that you're comfortable with. Just use PayPal, and like I say, it helps pay for server fees and the cost of this outrageously expensive webinar software and things along those lines. Okay, let's see. Let's get on with the show. I want to introduce a new presenter that I'm excited to have for the first time for everyone, John Ross. John specializes in high-end portrait, lifestyle, and product retouching. He's been working in the printing, photography, and retouching fields for more than 20 years. Most recently, he's been teaching retouching classes and writing articles about various techniques. We may or may not get a chance to discuss that during the show. We'll see how things go. Let's see, let me switch screens. So we're looking at John's screen. He'll need to click a button or two on his side. Hopefully.
Yep, you should see it.
Not yet. There we go. Welcome, John.
Hi, thank you. Thank you.
It's good to have you here. It's good to have new blood.
Well, thank you very much for having me, Doug.
Let's see here. We are starting to get questions already, and a couple of, or actually so far, just the one image. Let's see. Do you have your Dropbox folder handy?
Yes, I do.
We've got a NEF file in there. From Christian. I don't have a question from Christian. Maybe he can madly type in while that is opening for you. I'm going to repaste the upload link into the chat dialog in case some latecomers didn't see that. Why don't you go ahead and open Christian's NEF file there.
Actually, if you don't mind, I had wanted to do just a brief orientation.
You're right. I'm sorry. I'm getting ahead of things. It's a new presenter. We haven't broken each other in yet.
So, hi, everybody. My name is John Ross. I teach Photoshop classes and courses, and I do this fairly regularly. So I welcome any questions that you might actually have for me. Before we do get started with actually retouching your images, I just wanted to take a few fairly brief moments to talk about how I actually have Photoshop set up, because there are several things that I do a little bit differently than most other retouchers as far as making selections and how I interact with Photoshop. So just as a good way to get started, this way if I start doing things, you might understand why it does or does not work for you if you wanted to try and follow along. So what I actually do is I open up Ridge. Not generally, I'll usually work from Lightroom, but in this particular case I'm going to use Ridge. And I have a few images that I've already preloaded in here, as well as Lightroom. I just want to load this up. And I want to show you two different ways that I might actually bring images into Photoshop. And it certainly matters. The way that I like to work is with smart objects. Now, I understand that in many cases, smart objects actually scare people because they're very complex or convoluted, and they're definitely a bottomless pit of information that you need to know in order to effectively use them. However, for simple portraits, they are really amazing to use. And I'm going to show you a very simple way to get started. Mm-hmm. So I'm just going to pick a random image in Lightroom. And if you right-click on it, you can go down to Edit In. And, well, the first option is Edit In Adobe Photoshop CC. And I'm using 2014.1, by the way. But I'll go down into Open as Smart Object in Photoshop. Now, the real benefit of doing it this way is that if I make changes within the Develop module inside of Lightroom, for example, I'll open up the exposure, which is completely wrong, right?
Okay.
But that's okay. We can fix it later. So I'm going to go and right-click on the image just as soon as it lets me. Mm.
Yeah. Might have a few things loaded with the webinar software that are eating up your resources.
Yeah, maybe. Okay, so I'm going to close Lightroom. I can still do Edit In and then... or edit a smart object, as I just showed you, because it's not letting me. So that's one way that I bring it in. Now, a follow-up way of doing it is inside a Bridge or just simply dragging and dropping. But now watch what happens. Any way I approach this, I will have access to the raw information. So one way that I started showing, which made me look silly there, but by dragging and by right-clicking and
human,
editing smart objects,
silly. Human,
yeah, human, it'll edit, it'll open up in Photoshop as a smart object. The way that I'm doing it here, it's going to open up in Camera Raw first, and either way, I can make that change. Now, instead of clicking Open Image, if you hold down the Shift key, it'll change to Open Object, and I can then open it up this way. So, in any way that you actually approach it, you will be here at this point. Now, if you work as a simple open as image, you will have a background here, and then that raw information is lost. In this particular case, all I have to do is double-click back on that layer, and it opens up to Camera Raw, to which I can make further adjustments.
Okay.
So now I've done this. I click OK, and now it's going to open up this layer. It's going to resave the information on this layer. so I can keep working in Photoshop. If at any point in time I decide, you know what, it's still a little blown out, all you have to do is double click on it again, make your adjustment, and click OK. So between smart objects and adjustment layers, you can have a really non-destructive workflow. So that's one of the ways that I begin working on all of my images.
Okay.
With the added benefit is that if I come up here and go filter, sharpen, add noise, anything like that, after I do that and click OK, I can still have that noise information that I can double click on it and it comes right back. I could readjust and go OK. So nothing I do is ever permanent. Okay?
Marvelous.
So that's just a first start. So if you guys see me opening up as smart objects, this is why. So I'm never locked into predetermined pixel-based information. All right. Now, the second thing that I want to show you is making selections. There are many different ways of making selections inside of an image, from magic wands, lassos, marquees. However, I prefer to use Quick Mask and what's called color range. Color range will allow me to grab ranges of color throughout the image very quickly and easily, and then I will refine that using Quick Mask. The reason that many people don't show it as a selection method in training videos is because Photoshop is actually trying to mimic the darkroom. But the darkroom doesn't actually translate to the digital way of working, and it actually becomes a bit convoluted. So let me quickly show you working Photoshop's way. If I go select color range, I can click on his skin tone, and I'm trying to make an educated decision based off of this tiny little thumbnail, and that's definitely not easy to do. You do have different options down here, but this really doesn't help you either. But we do have Quick Mask, and this could work, except it's trying to mimic what's called a ruby lith, which is a transparent piece of plastic. And again, we can't see what we're doing. So I'm going to start by effectively breaking Photoshop to make this work a whole lot easier for us. Even though I want to use select color range, its settings are down here under the color menus where Quick Mask is. So if we give it a double click, this setting box comes up. And I'm going to change it from masked areas to selected areas. I'm going to change the opacity from 50% to 100%. And the color is determined based off of what type of images you generally work with. If you work with portraits, red isn't good because the skin is red and lips are red. However, green works great. If you work on landscapes, green not so good, red is good. So since I'm doing portraits, I'm going to make it green, selected, opacity 100%, and click OK. When you do this, it leaves you inside of Quick Mask, which means that if we go select color range, it's not there. So we have to uncheck this, so that it's regular gray again. Now I can go select color range. I can select the skin once again, but now I can change it to Quick Mask, and I can clearly see what is and is not selected. Okay?
Excellent.
So if I want the blues, look how quick and easy that is, right? So now color range is simply a good starting point. It is not absolute. So very quickly, I leave it on settings like this, generally 98% of the time. Localized color, 40%, range of 100%. I'm not going to explain all this, but this is how I generally work without much problem. I click OK, and now when it comes out, it gives me a selection. I can then click on the Quick Mask, and it brings me back to that same preview. But now I have what I generally refer to as a negative version of Photoshop. It's an inverted. Basically, we have all the options of all the tools and all the filters that Photoshop has to offer. However, it works exclusively on the mask. So now because of that, we can click on our brush and up here, pick your size, a hardness. I need a hard brush for what I'm going to do, so I'll leave it at 80%. I'm going to make my brush bigger. I'm going to take my Wacom tablet, and then I can simply paint away what I don't want selected. So depending on your selection, you could have a bigger brush, smaller brush. If you need to, you can zoom in and get up really, really close. So the way that it would work is here, I have white it's going to erase. If I flip it around to black, it's going to add. So once again, I can come in here and I can do this. Now, the reason I wanted to show you this as an example is because when I start working on the portraits that everyone is uploading, then you will be able to follow along with me and why mine is going to behave differently than what most people would have on their systems.
Very
good. Is that some good information for you, Doug?
Marvelous, marvelous. We're getting some questions and we're getting some uploads. There's a slight disjoint between the two.
Doug, where do we start?
Well, we already promised you were going to start with Christian's NEF file that he uploaded. But he has a very general question, and I'm hoping that maybe you can just zip through this in like 5 minutes. He just wants to know, how would you approach this for your retouching? Maybe like rather than actually do the retouching, if you just talk about your thought process.
Okay, so I will start by saying that what I'm any color or any tonal changes or anything that I do during this presentation, what I see on my monitor isn't necessarily what you're going to see on your monitor due to the compression and recording and internet and world and whatever. So we're just going to assume it looks awesome, okay? But when I look at something like this, what catches my eye is this, 100% this. When you look at an image...
The light rays.
So it's the light rays. Specifically this big white orb off to the side. When you work on an image for something more creative, a lot of what I do is editorial, so those are different types of rules. But in this case, it's something a little bit more artistic. And the general point here is that where does your eye go and where do you want it to go? Well, I want it to go to her face. I want to go up here into the glasses. But this pulls my eye over here to the left, and then this pulls my eye over here to the right. So I'm a little disconnected. Additionally, when I look at this image, where am I actually going to be looking? I want here, but again, now this of her hands and arms are pulling me down. Okay, so I'm looking everywhere but where I really want to. It's too much information. Now, it's not that I remove it. It's simply that I do a little sleight of hand, and I pull your eye into where I want it to go. And so this is a great place to start. So when I work on an image, the first question is it going to be exposure or is it going to be color? What do I start with? Well, I often say, well, what's the worst problem that this image has? So in this case, it's not the color that's bothering me, because sometimes, you know, you'll have mixed lighting or it just has a yellow or blue cast or something. Then I'll get that out of the way first. But in this case, what I really want to do is fix the exposure. And if you can think in black and white and not in color, because I'm always thinking in black and white, I'm working on the tonal range in my head. This tone and this tone and this tone, they're all kind of muted. They're all in the same general range. We need to separate that and expand it through the tonal range, which
now,
is absolutely
black. If I could pause you here for a second.
Sure.
I think it's pretty obvious. You explained pretty well how you're thinking the primary problem here is not the color range. I think that's pretty self-evident by looking at it. But what do you use to determine that there might or might not be a problem with the exposure?
Well, it's always subjective to each, but if you were to just, perchance, click this auto button right here, I don't suggest it, but if you do it, watch what will happen. You see what a significant push it did? It pushed the blacks down, it pushed the exposure up, and that's a full stop. Now, I don't recommend it because this now becomes blown out and we have other issues, but the point is you have to stop thinking in a limited range. I mean, you can, you know, everyone's art is different, but generally speaking, why do images pop? Because they have stark contrasts. They have a dynamic range in that tonal range from absolute black to absolute white. So by pushing this black this way and pushing the highlights this way, whether you necessarily like it or not, you have to agree that this is a much more dynamic image now.
Okay.
So what I would, and again, you know, what I'm looking at isn't necessarily correct, but I would just, even if it's a little, I give it just a little bit of a push to make it lighter here and darker here, with the primary reason being that lights come forward and blacks go, lights come forward and darks go backward. So if we lighten up the subject and darken up the background, immediately she starts coming out and separating herself from the background. Okay, that's one of the things that I do. Mm-hmm. And the other thing that I would do, not necessarily in this image because I happen to like the coloring, but if we were to warm her up and cool off the background, that will once again separate her from the background and make her come forward.
Okay, so short version is, when you look at this, your primary, your gut response, your initial take on the thing is to separate her from the background one way or the other.
Yeah, and again, you know, everyone has a different reasoning, but I that's one thing I would do, and the other thing I would generally do is get rid of this because it's just too distracting to me.
Okay, that's basically an extension of the same concept, again, is focusing on, like you said, choosing what you want to be the first thing you look at, and eliminating the things which compete.
Yes. And so one last thing that I want to show that I would do to this image that also talks about what I mentioned earlier is, by clicking on this here, once again, we're in camera raw, this is a gradiated filter. And this is going to give me the same settings that I last used. And that's one of my gripes with this. But I'm going to take this exposure, and I'm going to bring it down all the way just so you can see what I'm doing. I'm going to take this and do that. Okay, so I've created this gradient from the bottom. But if I take this and I bring it down just a little bit, doesn't even have to be a lot, and then I do a little bit over here, again, it doesn't have to be a lot. Then we remove that. Now where does your eye go?
Okay.
You're being focused more up here. I would still handle these elements a little bit differently, but we've removed this as being something obvious.
Does Lightroom have a way for you to toggle that so we can see the before and after of that last move?
Of the last move?
Of the gradient.
Okay, so this is before, and this is after.
Okay, it's subtle, but it's supposed to be subtle.
It is supposed to be subtle, absolutely. And when you do this on any general image, what happens is basically it just dims the ground that people are on, or lower areas that you aren't even focused on, and it helps bring your eye up. That's all it does.
Okay.
So this is something I do for many of my images, and I do it so subtly you don't even notice.
Excellent. Is there anything else major on this one here, or should we move on to another?
From a technical standpoint, it would be the flyaway hairs. So now there's the beauty and fashion and all the things, and many times they like the hair being all over the place. I, for one, never understood it, but that is, once again, a stylistic thing. But if we were trying to make this a very beautiful picture, which is, to me, it's the way the camera should have seen a scene, because nothing I ever do is actually so over the top that you even know I did anything at all. Mm-hmm. I like people to just see a perfect representation of the shot. And so to me, I would be removing all of these flyaway hairs.
All of them, or just the ones on the top?
No, I would actually end up cropping right along her hairline and then down here.
See, that's now, where, you know, as you said, it's all subjective.
Yeah, it's a matter.
She's got one hair that's growing out of the middle of the top of her head.
Yeah, kind of like an antenna.
Yeah. But aside from that, I like the hair, especially the way the light's hitting them. It's kind of a smoky look or whatever. So
yeah, you know, everybody has a different thing. I would see how it would look. It may look a little too cut out, and in which case I would leave pieces of it maybe. I don't know. I would have to do it and see how I felt about it. But in any case, I might remove the ones coming off her shoulder here. But if I do that, then maybe this would look unbalanced. I don't know.
Okay. So, well, you know, getting a peek into the way your mind works, that's why we're here. So.
Yep. Okay, so unless there's anything else. While I'm in here, I will click down here, this blue area down here. And these are the settings that it's going to import into Photoshop with. So here we have the bit depth of 8-bit versus 16, your color space, and we don't want to resize it. We want it at full size. And down here, if you always want smart objects, you could check this, and then it would always open it up as a smart object. Otherwise, hold the shift key, open object, and then it would open it up into Photoshop, to which we can then start working in other parts of it.
Excellent.
With adjustment layers.
Okay.
All right, excellent.
Let's move on to Carlos's images. He uploaded a before and after, and he just wants to get your general thoughts and comments on his technique, things you might have done differently, etc.
Gotcha. Okay. I'm hesitating.
It's a wonderful photograph, by the way. I don't know if Carlos did that, but it's a wonderful photograph to begin with.
No, it is. I'm hesitating because it's a light image, and this monitor of mine that I'm just teaching on, it does everything bright, so I'm trying to evaluate how bright this actually is. Mm-hmm. And so since I don't actually know, what I can do is click on my eyedropper, open up the info palette, and then simply hover over an area, and then the values come up over here. And I work in CMYK. I do use RGB, but I check my numbers in CMYK because it's easier to use. It's like painting as a child. You know, you mix
magenta and yellow. That's kind of a giveaway as to your background.
You get orange. As a child? Yes.
As to the way you started in retouching.
I come from a printing background.
Yeah,
I was
exactly.
I was in art college, and my first job, I was hired as a manager, and I'm like, what are you kidding me? I don't know anything. But, and be that as it may, so I started in printing. I worked in printing for 15 years, so printing is CMYK, but I've migrated that over to my retouching because it's just easier to understand the values that are actually happening. For example, when I look at those values of black being only 33%, it really is as light as it appears to me on my screen, whereas over here there's zero, and it really is as light as it appears. So basically, from a printing standpoint, having 0000 is bad because it's a lack of dot, even on an inkjet printer. It basically means that somewhere in here it has to start a dot. And when it comes to actual printing for magazines, not to get into any heavy topic, but if we go from this 313 down to zero, you're going to see a line. There's just going to be a straight line that just is incorrect. You'll see banding. Banding would happen. So to compensate for that, it may look a little odd to you, but I would use curves. And the curves, I use this palette because it's a single click for me. Curves are otherwise under the layers palette. And then curves, but that's two extra clicks, so that's why I don't use it. And then I would come over here to the white and white corner, the top right, and simply bring it down just a tiny little hair, and then I'll remark off where it was. And then if you come over here and now look, now what used to be white, see all the zeros, is now 3, 2, 2. It's just something. It gives it something to print when printing time comes.
So, now, if you're just working, really you're talking like a 2% or less even.
Yeah, no, tiny, tiny numbers. Because even on your inkjet printer, you know, at home, you will, this will give you a less abrupt end to the line. So unless you're doing just straight Facebook web type of portfolio things, yeah, you should always just put in a tiny little bit of a dot. And even if you were to use levels, if that's better for you, levels would be down here. Just move it just a teeny tiny little bit.
I'm guessing, I mean, that's fine for correction, but wouldn't it be better if you took that into consideration from the start?
Oh, absolutely.
Okay.
Yes. While we can agree that we definitely like the image, there's a technical aspect that I'm just addressing.
And Carlos has already typed in that he really appreciated that.
You're welcome. So when you're looking on your screen in Photoshop, it might look a little dirty to you. However, I guarantee you, you'll never actually see it during print. It would still be the white of the paper.
We did the white. What about the blacks?
The blacks. Okay, so now this comes into subjective, where the blacks are definitely very weak. They're very weak. And now,
right about the subjective. I was wondering if Carlos intended that or if that's just the way it came out.
Yeah, possibly. Now, the other thing to understand when you look at those values of cyan, magenta, yellow, and black up in the corner there, the cyan is the heaviest of 93%, mm-hmm. which means irrelevant of what we actually see on our screen, because, you know, they may be calibrated or not or whatever, but this is going to print bluish. It's going to have a blue tint to it. So if we wanted it to be a warmer image, then we would make sure that the magentas and yellows were higher than the cyan.
For our RGB fans, you can also see that the B value over in the RGB is quite heavy.
All right. Well, I'll nerd out on you. And if you wonder which is which, if you ever wondered why, if you open up like a curve or something, and if you go to, let's say, blue, if I go one way, it's going to go blue. But if I go the other way, it goes yellow. And your brain hurts and you don't understand it, because I've been doing this forever and I can't work that way. It hurts my head. Basically, if you look up here in the info palette, red is the complementary color of cyan, green is complementary to magenta, and blue is complementary to yellow.
I just remember the letters are the same order, CMYRGB. So just I do some little mental gear shifting in my head, but that's my little mnemonic that I use.
It is a mental gymnastics, and that's why I can't stand working this way. I'll see other retouchers, and they'll go into these different channels using curves and levels, and it kills me, because levels and curves are a tonal tool. We're trying to work on the tonal range, blacks and whites. However, they're making color changes, which makes no sense to me. Why not use a color-based tool, which is down here, as selective color? With selective color, now we have the option of grabbing the reds, yellows, greens, cyan, blues, magentas. Oh, look, they're right there, right? But we have individual control over them. Plus, we have the tonal range. So in this case, if I wanted to grab those magentas over there, I would simply grab magenta, and then now I can adjust them here using, once again, cyan, magenta, yellow, black, which works like when we were kids painting. If I wanted this to look orange instead of magenta, well, magenta and yellow make orange. There you go. Now we have a brighter red. Yeah. And if anybody cares, the two buttons at the bottom, to make it simple, relative is less, absolute is more. You probably can't see it on your display, but this has a weaker red and that has a stronger red now.
I'm sure there's a show there, but okay.
Yeah. So anyway, I do color using a color tool, which is selective color. And then I may or may not use masking, because in many cases I don't even need to, because I can just grab individual pieces. Okay, so for me personally, and this is completely personally, mm-hmm. I find this to be too bleached out. It lacks the contrast I mentioned before, but that's subjective. Of anything, I would probably do exactly what I just did and make that red punch, this red and this red. Give it a little bit more snap. And then I guess personally, if I was going to come over here with this, I'd bring the blacks, even if it's just a little bit. I guess, just to put a little bit more density back into it. You know, but again, that's me. I think the story is in the blood red. But you know, and then even on her lips, she has the makeup on. So I would have punched this up higher. But okay, so ultimately, that's that. And if there's anything else, I don't know. I like the image.
Excellent. All right.
Any straight questions?
Let's see here. I had one interesting question here, and this is a very controversial subject over in our forums. Phil wants to know if you use frequency separation.
Oh, okay. So depending on the circles that you run in, there has fairly recently been, in the past few months, a lot of top talk about frequency separation, whether it's any good, how to use it. I won't mention other websites, but if you know what I'm talking about, you know what I'm talking about.
Personally, I do know what you're talking about, but we'll leave it as a mystery to everybody else.
Yeah, there you go. Go do a search. It's so anyway, there's some people that frequency separation is a big fancy word. So wannabe retouchers, and I'll use that loosely, but wannabe retouchers say, hey, here's the catchphrase, let's go do it. And they'll go do frequency separation, and effectively what it does is it turns the skin, supposed to be porcelain, but it really just blurs the whole skin out, and you lose all the pores and the detail and everything else.
Getting a bit of a negative vibe towards
the concept.
Now, hold
on. Bear with me. Bear with me. Basically, the problem is it's used too much and it's used too far. And in the circles that I was referring to, they're basically saying that when used under controlled situations, practice, get used to it, then it's a fine tool. And I think it is. I think it's okay to use. To answer the direct question of do I use it, not really.
For the uninitiated in the audience, frequency separation is the technique of separating the high detail areas of the image from the low details of the areas of the images, and then hitting buttons randomly. And then treating them separately, mostly using filters and stuff. Personally, I think it is a gimmick and lazy, and as you said, it ends up with mushy results. However, there is always somebody that can take any technique, no matter what it is, and come out with beautiful results. And so, I am not trying to stomp on anyone here, criticize anyone here. There is always somebody. There are people that can do wonderful things with the most mundane tools within Photoshop, and there are people, other people like myself, that can't do a lot of things to save their lives. And so, you know, if it works for you, that is great. However, it is a trendy thing right now.
Exactly.
A lot of people are treating it like the secret sauce. And I've been doing a lot of these shows for many years, and I have yet to come across a serious retoucher that takes it seriously. It is mostly it is a meme, a retouching meme right now. And so,
I'll even take that a little bit further, Doug, if I could. I found that I work in a bubble, meaning I sit in my studio and I use Photoshop. Because I teach classes, I like to grow and expand. I get questions, and I play a lot. I want to learn. And I find that during my experimentation, I settle into how I like to work because it works for me. And I think I'm being special or isolated, or I'm not expanding my horizons, basically, because I work the same way day in and day out. When I'll watch videos of the high-end professionals that you can find, once again, on other websites.
RetouchPRO.com/rentals.
Oh, well, there you go. That's a good example. That's a very good example. I mean, the point is you listen to what they do and how they do it and why they do it, and suddenly I realize, well, I'm not the odd one out. They're doing the same thing. Like, they'll remap the keyboard to better match.
It always amazes me how it's a bad word. It's not the right word, but it is a figurative word. Low tech, a lot of the high-end professionals work.
Very simply a lot of the time. I don't know. Yeah, a lot of my techniques go back to old school. You and I were talking about that earlier, where even though Photoshop has all these fancy features, I can teach you Photoshop on Photoshop 7 from 10 years ago. I mean, I don't care. The core techniques are there because they are that good.
Yeah.
And anything else is fluff just to make life easier.
If your technique requires something that was just introduced 6 months ago or a year ago or whatever, I would second guess that and think that maybe you're leaning on a crutch a little too heavy.
Yeah, possibly. Possibly. Okay, is there any other question?
We've got Ari has a couple of images, I believe, in there, a before and an after. He says, not interested in the people, but the car. What did it do with the areas that are too dark and the areas blown out that may overall affect the feel and look of the image? Should he keep them or try to adjust them? Like, should he make the blacks lighter or to get more details in the areas? I think you get the general gist.
Okay. Is the question, how do we make the car punchier?
I think he's wanting to know, did he make it too punchy? Did he not make it punchy enough?
Okay. I can see. All right. So when – all right.
This is different from the other image we did, and he's talking primarily about the tone here, I think.
No, absolutely. So what's striking me here, once again, when I hover over the side of the car – I'm sure everybody's with me now that 0000 is not good.
Okay.
Okay, so basically there's no detail here. This entire side of the car is devoid of detail. Okay, it's just flat. It's flat and quite honestly disinteresting. Mm-hmm. That's a problem. Additionally, this could have something to do a little bit with the JPEG compression, but what's happening here is pixelization. And this is falling apart, once again, lacking detail. But we'll kind of let that one go, assuming it's just a JPEG or whatever.
I suspect you're right.
Yeah. When we come down here and I look into this area, once again, now we seem to have the same problem where we're high on the cyans, magenta is high, low on yellow, and black is down at the bottom. And black, because it's down here in this darker area, black should definitely be a bit punchier. This whole front end is dark, so like this should be a piece of information, but this just kind of falls, I don't know, it just comes off as a bit dark to me. And once again, I look at the numbers in cyan, so now it has this blue cast, not like a silver car. I mean, this would actually print on the bluer side. So what would I do? I think what we ultimately, my first thing is, well, I'd have to go back to the raw file in order to get back this lost information. Mm-hmm. But assuming that was there, let's see, if I was to open up a curve, which, by the way, very quick curve lesson, here's your tonal range, absolute black, here's your midtone, and here's your absolute white. And you take that and you kick it sideways. So once again, here's your black, here's your midtones, and here is your whites. If we go up, it's turning on the lights and the image gets brighter. Pull it down and the lights go out and the image gets darker. So now that we're all curve experts, what we need to do is this area right here. And if you don't actually know where you are, you can click on this little hand thing right there, click, and see how it added a point to the curve line. And now I'm pulling that up and down. So this should come up where the darker area should go down. Okay, see how it created this, it brought this area up and then this area down a little bit. Sometimes I wish I could zoom in a little, but if you wanted to, you could click on it and use your arrow keys to also move up and move down. That works too. All right, so I think right there you can see that I've separated the front grille from the front hood a little bit more. Mm-hmm. And something else that I might actually do just to make this a little bit more visually dynamic, and again, follow along with me. If I right-click on this, because right now we're in a JPEG, but if I right-click on this background layer and I say Convert to Smart Object, you don't have to. I'm just simply doing it. I can now come up under Filter, add Camera Raw Filter. This was introduced in CS6. This takes me into Camera Raw, so I have access to these same functions, which for whatever reason are not built into Photoshop to this day. But we can now use this layer as if it was a raw file. And what that means is effectively I can take my clarity. Now I don't use clarity, but because this is a car, I want clarity. Once again, look at all that extra detail that starts punching out on the vehicle. Now we don't want to use it overall because it's grabbing areas outside of the vehicle, but right in that car, that looks great. So I'm going to click OK. Now watch what I've done here. By having a smart object, I have this as a smart filter that I can turn off and turn on. Like I click this and I hide it, and I click it again and I show it again. But it also has this mask, and this is called the layer mask. And this is going to affect only the filters that I apply to this vehicle. And now like I showed when this thing began with the quick mask, I can click on the mask. So notice how it has this extra frame around it. If I click here, it has a frame. Click there, it has the frame. So I'm clicking right there. I'm going to take my paintbrush, open up the brush, and I can actually paint with black because black is a concealer, and I can remove all of this effect from around the vehicle. Of course, I'm going really fast and really cheesy, but you totally see the point that now I can turn it off, I can turn it on, I can double click on the filter, I can adjust the settings, and then I can go back very quick, very easy. And I think within a few moments, I've actually made this car look way more interesting.
Yes, you have.
I can't do anything about this right here because devoid of detail is straight up devoid of detail. But if you could go back to a more original, you can get this back, you can get the sky back. The greens are too saturated, those should be pulled down. How would I do that? Very simply, grab selective color and greens and simply pull down the cyan and pull down the yellow, and then there we didn't even have to make a mask. We just simply toned that down a bit. Actually, it's not tone. We just brought the color down a bit so it's not as saturated. That's one way of doing it. I could have used hue saturation, but then I'd need a mask. This way I didn't need the mask. Okay, so I think we've worked out that image.
Excellent.
Thank you very much. What
Thank
else
you,
got?
Harry. It just occurred to me this is supposed to be a portrait show, and
I don't care. It's all the same. It really is. It's all the same. The techniques are all the same. It doesn't matter what the actual image is.
Just want to remind people when you're typing in questions, please include your file name, and if you've uploaded a file, please type in a question. Fernando has an image there that looks interesting to me, and he just wants to know, do you consider the dark shadow a fault? And if so, what can be done?
What am I looking at? Oh, this one, this guy?
Yes.
Okay. So what's the question?
He wants to know if you consider the dark shadow a fault.
Under his chin down here?
I got to assume, because I kind of like the ones on the edges.
Or these? Oh, okay. The shadow. Okay, so in this case, no. You know what it is? Let me reiterate. This, I like the shadow because it separates him from the background. Mm-hmm. Like, it's giving this edge, so I like that. What he's doing here is he has that, what do they call that when they darken the edges
the
of
vignette a... vignette or edge burn?
Yeah, the vignette, thank you. Yeah, it's this vignette. Personally, this is just personally, I absolutely hate vignettes like this.
Yeah,
I would have done.
You.
Yeah, I would have done what I did earlier, which is using the gradiated filter and coming in and start doing it individually with different degrees. You know, it doesn't have to be that full degree.
So you dislike the vignettes in principle or just to the degree that Fernando's done here?
No, just in principle. I don't like this because it's obvious. Remember what I said? I like to make the perfect photograph as it came out of the camera.
Okay.
Something like this to me is a special effect. And I don't do special effects. I like to make things as natural as I possibly can.
Marvelous.
And I like to sneak it in.
Controversy. So another, I love controversy.
You know what? I speak my mind. I say what I want to say. And I used to think that I'm saying things that are wrong and gibberish. But then I said something once about some Photoshop release and why I hated it so much. And then I think I'm going to get chastised for it. And a bunch of people said, hey, you know what? Why is it that way? I don't understand. And I've actually seen changes in Adobe from articles I've written and things I've said. Right now I have top 10 reasons that Photoshop is still not right for photographers. I have 10 more reasons why Photoshop is not right for photographers. And I even have another 10 more that I'm waiting for their next release. Every time they come out with a release, I give them 10 more things to fix because I don't know why Photoshop works the way it does, simply because they're dealing with video and graphic designers and 3D renderers.
I fought really hard for a feature, and it turns out that they couldn't do it because a huge base of Photoshop users are cartoonists, and it was built a certain way to suit them. I got that lecture from an engineer.
All right. So they have their reasons. I have mine, but I'm still going to be very vocal because I think somebody in the industry should be, and I don't mind because, I've never had anybody really say that I'm totally completely wrong, go back into my cave. So that's fine. How I would handle this, I showed you one way in Camera Raw with the gradient. In this case, I'm going to click on gradient. I'm going to click on my quick mask with the settings the way I showed you earlier. I would do it this way. Something like this. Come out of quick mask. And then now that we have a selection, I can click on curves and I can bring the curves down just a little bit. Now we already have the existing, so
yeah,
this gets
yeah.
to be a little bit much, but I can grab the lighter area, which is here, that's bothering me. It's too bright. And I would do it this way. And if you find, generally speaking, that I don't think it affects this image, but if you find that you start getting saturation because curves and levels start adding saturation to the image while it's darkening it, you can take the blend mode and change it to luminosity so it's limited only to the tonal range.
That's actually a very good tip. I hope people were listening or they rewind if this was on YouTube. That's a very good tip right there.
Okay, so let me just show you, generally speaking, without any mask, I'm going to go curves and I'm going to do this. Okay, you can see how it got darker, but it kind of saturated the skin.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, before, after. So I'm going to click on luminosity and then before,
there you go.
After. Before and after. So as you can see, that's why I would say 99% of my levels and curves are set to luminosity, which is one of my, on one of my lists for Adobe. Why can't I set luminosity to be the default? That's how I use it. So I don't know why I can't set that. as a preference. All right, so that's how I worked on that image. What else we got? We're getting a bunch of images here.
Excellent.
What should I do?
Thank you, Fernando. We've got Martin. He has a before after, and he just wants to get pretty much your gut response to it the same way you've done before here.
Martin.
There's
okay.
More
running
than
out of times. Running out of time, so I'm going to go quickly. When I look at this, here's your after, and that's the before. I keep grabbing these randomly and going in the wrong direction.
Okay. If you can't tell the difference, that right there is a key thing to keep in mind.
Yeah, no, it's me just setting my expectation here. All right, so I'm on this image here. When I hover over the whites, we have a tone inside of the magenta and yellow. That's good. Magenta is higher. So that means that when this prints, it's going to be on the pink side, which might be fine, you know, especially with the purple going on. So that's 100%. Just pointing out that if you want it a little bit warmer, then have the yellow a little bit higher. But ultimately, both values should be within 5 of each other, generally speaking. And the bridge of the nose would be the correct place generally, because that would be the perfect skin tone. And when I look at those values, 5 cyan is right. 5 to 9, magenta of 38 and yellow of 36. It's a bit warm, generally about 27, 29 would be perfect, but generally speaking, that is fine. I'd be very happy with that. Once again, you can see that we have the dynamic range, you have the brights, you have the darks. When I come to the darks, black high, once again, cyan's higher, so this is generally going to print as a cooler image. With the magentas and the hair.
What about the skin and the hair?
Yeah, that's what I'm getting into. So when we look at the skin here.
I see pores, always a good thing.
Yeah, you know, if you see hair, yes, you can leave it. That's what people take out too much. But I do like the hair. I like...
Actually, now that you zoomed in, I'm thinking he did a pretty good job.
Yeah, I mean, he did a great job. Since I am here to complain and critique, so don't take it personally, that's what I'm here for, I would say that if you went that far for everything, how about the whites of her eyes?
Yeah.
She has these veins. So for the one time I recommend doing this, up under your healing, there's the healing brush. I use the healing brush tool for the skin regularly and not the spot healing, because the spot healing has a tendency to smudge as it goes. But in this particular case, spot healing brush with content aware, extremely important. The content aware is on. Proximity match is the default, and it's horrible. Content aware works. Make a tiny, tiny brush here and then simply do this. Because we don't have anywhere proper to copy from, that's why I use the spot healing. And that'll just let us get in here and do what we need to.
But again, don't go overboard. But yeah, minimize, but don't eliminate.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So you get what I'm doing. I mean, there's no reason that these should be in here as heavy as they are. That's all. Okay.
It's an interesting crackle effect in her eye there. I don't know if that's part of the compression or what, but that was strange. She had like a crackalure effect over there. I think it might just be the compression.
All right, so generally speaking, yes, I like that. I like the hair personally. It's nice, it's clean. It's a bit on the soft side with his cloning. It doesn't have... All right, so how do I put this? I can see on mine anyway. It could be the JPEG compression, but I don't know if this is necessarily banding.
Mouse tracks there.
Yeah, and then this is just so smooth and soft that it lacks, again, you know, subjective for what you're looking for.
Looks a bit like a helmet.
Yeah, a little bit. You know, sometimes it helps to leave fault. The more faults you leave, the more realistic it looks. So in this case, I mean, you're kind of limited. I mean, once you get rid of the flyaway hairs, this is kind of how it is. But I guess ultimately, I don't know. I'm not working on the file. So I can't be more specific. Ultimately, I'd say I like it. If I'm going to change anything on this, if I'm going to do anything personally, I would get rid of this zigzag. It's too obvious.
That's the first thing that caught my eye when you opened it.
Yeah, sadly, it's the last thing that caught my eye. But yeah, you don't have to remove it. Just simply take a darker color from the hair, you know, clone it, add an opacity, and just fill it in.
Actually, I was thinking about making it more severe, but that's just, again, that's subjective.
Oh, I guess.
But it did catch my eye that it didn't really seem to go with the rest of the image. The rest of the image is so carefully manicured and precise, and then you've got that kind of sloppy, messy zigzag in the hair.
Yep, absolutely.
Okay.
Okay.
Got the time for one more, maybe. Christoph. J. Christoph. He wants to know, did he overdo his dodge and burn technique? First of all, wonderful image.
Yeah, I'm pretty engulfed by the image. I just want to keep looking at it. You know, even down here where I keep saying darken, you know, I like it.
I think Christoph might be humble bragging. I think he's uploaded a wonderful thing and then say pick it apart when he knows there's really not all that much we can do about it.
No, I want to complain about the hair, but I can't. She doesn't have bags under her eyes, but she still has shape to them. I can see, despite the compression, I can see that she has hair, she has foot. Yeah, great. What am I supposed to complain about again?
Dodge and burn.
Oh, dodge and burn. Did he do too much? No, absolutely not. He did an excellent job.
So the answer there, Christoph, is no. You did not do too much.
No, he did a great job. Even up through the hair, whatever he did to handle the hair, it just has a nice rim. I love it. Okay, what else we got? Give me.
Let's see here. Phil. You got one named Phil? Yeah, there he is, Phil Kogan. Shot with a camera flash, wanted the face sharper than the hair. I guess he's wanting how to even out the sharpening without making the hair go nuts.
Oh, okay. Okay, so simply put, the easy way is duplicate the layer so that you're working on a copy of it. And I would go to my quick mask or lasso or however you're comfortable working with a brush, paintbrush, bring this up. And I'm going to, too hard, and drop this down. Hold on. Now I'm randomly clicking things. Come back. Okay. Yes. Okay. So very quickly, I would come in here and do this. Now, if you're following along from the previous car image, you could do the exact same thing and ultimately better with a smart object.
Mm-hmm.
But okay, so we've come out of here and we've added this on this layer here. Apply that mask. See that? So now here, with that selected, I would go filter, sharpen. This is a big, long topic of what sharpen you should use.
Sure.
I've done a lot of testing on the topic, and I'm going to go with smart sharpen. I've tried many, 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 many different things, and I use smart sharpen. It gives the best results, generally speaking. So there is high pass, and that's a very nice way to work, but it's more complex, and it requires me to think, and I hate to think. So now, two things I'll point out, that with a 202, it helped the eyes a lot, but it sharpens the noise. So that's partially, our JPEG here, but assuming that this really is a problem, in all my images, I remove noise first, not to plug any particular company, because there's several out there, but I would remove the noise first with a denoise filter. Personally, if you've noticed up under here, filter, image, not that one.
Topaz. No, red giant.
No, I don't use topaz. In fact, I don't care for it. I don't like topaz because there's too many options. I'm surprised. I don't have it in here.
That is a valid. Well, this is your teaching computer, so not your working.
Yeah. No. So it just depends on what I need. So.
But what is
so ultimately? Sure many people have heard of Noise Ninja, but that was discontinued years ago, and they rolled it into a product. Oh, Noise Ninja is amazing. They rolled it into a product called Photo Ninja, which is actually a raw processor. So I don't use the whole raw processing part of it. I only use it exclusively for the Noise Ninja part. So Photo Ninja, and I use its denoise engine. Now, inside of Photoshop, technically, yes, there is a denoise. They have a, noise, reduce noise. But here's the difference. It looks the same if you just compare the two of them. But if you reduce noise or Noise Ninja separately, and then go to sharpen the image, reduce noise will still allow you to sharpen noise. Noise Ninja does a finer job somewhere in the its engine somewhere so that it will sharpen less noise as I follow up. So I'm reducing noise and then I'm sharpening. So Noise Ninja just gives you a better result than reduce noise, even though they kind of look the same.
Do you ever use the denoise filter in Camera Raw?
So it's the same, effectively the same as this. Okay, so you'll get the same results in the denoise inside of Camera Raw as you will inside of reduce noise, and it's also the same as you can find, oddly enough, inside of Sharpen, Smart Sharpen, but hiding here, reduce noise. So you see how we have that? I can crank this up, and I can get rid of that noise, but as you can imagine, it's just going to end up, smudging it over.
Okay.
Okay, it removed the noise, but then we have other issues that actually come up, which is why I don't use this. But this is the same slider that's in three different locations.
Excellent.
And once again, Photo Ninja will do the better job if you can afford to go pick up the software. It's worth it. Okay, so Smart Sharpen, and that's how I would do it here. Filter, Sharpen, Smart Sharpen. I've been in here like how many times, and I never actually hit apply. When it finishes, you'll see that because these are separated, it's going to sharpen her face and not her, it'll sharpen her, not her hair. And ultimately, I would focus more on the eyes instead of just like the whole face. I would do the eyes, the lips, but here we go, because that's the mask. You can see that when I zoom in here, before and after.
Okay, would you go in and like paint out the skin on the mask, just leaving the eyes and lips?
Yeah, no, absolutely. So if I click on the mask to see what I'm doing, if you hit the backslash on the keyboard, which is above the enter key, you can see your mask again and just fill it in like this. Yeah, this is exactly how I would end up doing it.
Marvelous.
You get the idea.
It's actually kind of cool looking on its own.
All right, so this way, you know, we're only sharpening just the eyes and the lips. And I'll actually, personally, I do the nostrils as well. Don't ask me why, it just gives it more.
It's light. It's a high contrast area that is a like a biomarker. It's something that we register on a subconscious level. So no, that's perfect. That's just as important as the eyes or lips.
Okay. Excellent.
Excellent. Let's see here. Jerry says, hang on one second here. He was unfamiliar with you before today's show, but he's very impressed with your techniques. Where are you located? Where can you find your courses? He also wanted to know about those 10 tips you were talking about earlier.
Okay. All right. So you can find me here at theartofretouching.com.
All one word, no punctuation.
Nope. Theartofretouching.com. And this is my website. And I have regular tutorials that I post. If you want to know more about smart objects and smart filters, here it is. And the videos are all very short. I make them as short as I can. They're all edited down, so that's 9 minutes. In 9 minutes, you'll have a full working knowledge of smart objects. Down here is the current month's issue of Advanced Photoshop Magazine. So this is December. This is in December's issue, and I've got another something coming out in the January issue, and then back here somewhere was September's issue of the Advanced Photoshop Magazine. Anyway, so if you want to learn more about me, go to this website. Over here I have a video course that that I walk through Photoshop basics, and I also have live classes. If you click up here, you can always see my current schedule.
Those 10 tips are a blog post on there? Or the 10 complaints you mentioned are a blog post?
Yep. So they're probably still viewed on the website. You can click on articles. It's probably just in the blog somewhere anyway.
Well, if we leave it a mystery, that means I'll have to read more, which is always a good thing.
10 things still missing in Photoshop CC for retouchers. And I must have misclicked something, unless it's just hiding in there.
Yeah, I'm sure it's in there somewhere.
Yeah, so I have 10 things missing and 10 things still missing. And Julianne Cost, she had, if you know who she is, she had read my article and she forwarded it on to the Adobe engineers to make sure that they knew exactly what I was what I had to say. So
very cool. Anything else you want to show us before we head out of here?
Me personally, no. Just if you want to know about me, sign up for any of my classes or videos. I mean, I got a ton of free videos. I've got classes.
Now you teach via webinar too, like we're doing here.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Same software. I teach live. I teach students from around the world. So I try and mix up the times when I'm doing it live as much as I can. But you know, I have students that come in here. I have a classroom, and here are some smaller courses that I have.
If somebody wants to come in person, what part of the world are you located in?
I'm in New Haven, Connecticut. So I get people that come from New York. They come to my classes. They're not expensive, but you get exactly what you just got, a very quick orientation thereof. So thank you very much for the kind words. And I'd also like to say how awesome it is that I end this with more people than I started with. You know, the attendee list. So that's pretty cool. I didn't lose anybody along the way. I was a little worried.
That's a little inside baseball there, but yes, that is a key cue that we have as to how things are going. I am going to switch back over to my screen real quick here as we wind things up. To remind everyone to subscribe on Twitter, to subscribe on YouTube. And don't forget to become a patron of Retouch Pro if you can. There are some perks. It's not just money disappearing. It does actually have some tangible benefits, although they're more along the lines of thank you gifts rather than payment for services. Little things like a little badge to let everybody know when you post that you're a patron, and it increases your upload limits and things along those lines.
I just paid yesterday, by the way, Doug.
Thank you. You're the first presenter I've had that actually paid to do one of these shows, which is
nice. No, I signed up as a renewal. I've been a paying member for.
You're actually one of the earliest ones I checked.
Really?
Yeah. Cool. Yeah. And also to remind everybody about our video rentals. Again, these are two and a half, sometimes even longer, start to finish retouches. Take a look at all those. There's close to 100 of them up there. There's certain to be one in an area of interest to you. Well, John, how do you think it went, your first show?
Oh, I think it went pretty awesome. And if you think I just gave you everything that I had to offer, then you're sadly mistaken.
Oh, no.
I can do stuff like that all day long.
We didn't even get to all the images that people uploaded, which I apologize for, but tell everybody to hang on to the images. We don't hang on to them. I want to assure everyone that we do delete all of the uploaded images immediately after the show. But if we did not get to your particular problem, please hang on to those images, and hopefully we'll be able to schedule another show with John quite soon, and you can re-upload them at that time.
Oh, actually, if I could, Doug, one last thing. On my website, mm-hmm. I do have behind-the-scenes retouching videos, and at the bottom of each of those videos, you are able to submit to me images if you wanted me to review them and possibly do a video recording of them. To help others as well. So
there you go. All right. Well, on that note, I will thank everyone for showing up today. Special thanks to John, a good premiere in my opinion, I think. There is a survey after the show for everyone, so you can let me know how you felt about it. That will be interesting. If you stick around after the show and fill that out, I'd certainly appreciate it. But in the meantime, thanks everyone for showing up, and I will see you in the forums. Bye-bye, everyone. Bye-bye, John.
Thanks, Doug.